For this particular ceremony, it is a junior leadership ceremony, a ceremony that some of our students, class of 2006, Will O'Leary and Chuck Haycox, helped to put together. And I'm very proud that we have continued that tradition that they have started way back in 2004, when they were juniors. So, thank you. I'm going to ask you to remain seated. We'll invite the juniors to come up and take their place, and then we'll continue on with acknowledgement, espacio and acknowledgement. So, juniors. So I mentioned to the juniors that this act of them lining up and coming in is a little bit of a foretaste of next year. As seniors, it should be a very quick reminder that you will be very soon assessing for the last time this community sending you not finished, but ready. And so in that same spirit of sending out men who are ready, not done or fitted, but ready, we have this ritual that invites the juniors to take their place after junior retreat as those soon to be seniors and leaders of the class. You'll be initiated very publicly into that position by the members of the senior leadership team. And so giving thanks for the juniors, giving thanks for the leadership of the seniors, and giving thanks for this community that continues to produce young men with courage and confidence and integrity. I invite you to spend some time in espacio giving thanks for all of those gifts that this community invites you to accept and challenge and discover. So I invite you to please sit up straight. That position of intentionality, planted firmly but gently on the ground. Ask you to take a nice deep breath in. Quiet the exhale. Close your eyes as you take another deep breath in.
going to be a spectacular weekend. Lots to look forward to. Let's look back, though, upon this week. Take a minute, just think of anybody who helped you with your week, helped you make it a little more navigable or more pleasant. So, acknowledgements. Mr. Wood.
I'd like to acknowledge my colleagues for helping out with my classes.
I'd like to acknowledge my co-captain Benji for being there for me this week.
Consider.
I'd like to acknowledge
senior class vice president, Kaylin Santos. Melissa's been initiating the class of 2015 as they set up and take their place next year as upper classmen and student leaders in our school community. Leadership isn't something you put on casually, but rather, leadership is a quality that you develop, a habit of character you practice every day in moments both big and small. And so, on behalf of the class of 2014, I welcome our junior class brothers as they accept this important responsibility for leadership.
At this time, I invite Meadow to come up and share his reflections on your guys' freshman year.
In August of 2011, a special group of 50 guys walked into Stewart Hall, excited to begin their high school journey. During our orientation, we all realized what made our class so special. At that event, Mr. Farrell gave a couple remarks about why the class of 2015 is a new class. Although I do not remember his exact words, I do remember he introduced us as the revival class. We revived Stewart Hall. After the class of 2014, our current seniors had financially saved the school from closure. Our class showed the city that Stewart Hall is not dead, but alive and well. One of my favorite memories from freshman year was our spring retreat at the Rose Course. As I look back on that retreat, we bonded more as a class and strengthened our camaraderie. We overcame some trials and tribulations that year, only to emerge as a stronger class. We started out as novices in the high school story, and now we were uncertain about how our next 4 years would pan out. We were all beginning a new chapter of our lives. Throughout the 2011-2012 school year, it did not take us long to realize how much talent is in our class. We have athletes, musicians, scholars, leaders, the lot. Towards the end of freshman year, I concluded that we, the class of 2015, were in for a fun and exciting four-year adventure, and that we would have to enjoy every minute of it, as it would fly by faster than we would imagine. We would soon become the best class that has ever walked through the gates of Stewart Hall.
Let me tell you that there is nothing more comforting than having a class as great as this to go through sophomore year with.
Whether it was struggling to find your spirit animal, losing a fair number of classmates, studying enough to pass the chemistry final, or continuing to fight and build your own identity, I couldn't have done it without all of you. So thank you.
Are as my charge to you for the next year. And these words come from William Shakespeare. Be in their flowing cups, freshly remembered. This story shall be what the good man teaches his son. And Crispin Crispian shall ne'er go by from this day to the ending of the world. But we in it shall be remembered. We few, we happy few, we band of brothers. For he today that sheds his blood with me shall be my brother. The man to your left, the man to your right, he may not be your best friend, but he is your brother. You may not spill blood together, but you certainly share time and laughter and pain and sometimes tears. You are sharing an experience with 49 other men who no one else in history before you or after you will ever experience, which is the way in which the men of 2015 have navigated their experience at the hall. So in 1 year, when it is your time to graduate, my prayer for you is that you can stand on the graduation stage next to any other man from the class of 2015, link arms, and say, we few, we happy few, we band of brothers. Thank you.
Expectancy As we begin this new stage of our journey,
take from us all fear of the unknown, and teach us to rest treasures from darkness and evil.
As the days come and go, may we find that each one is laden with happy opportunities and enriching experiences.
God, renew us today, and you make your love.
Grant us your light, grant us your grace, grant us your joy on this special day.
And as we continue to grow in mind and spirit, grant that our best hopes be more than ever fulfilled.
We ask this in your name, God of us all, and giver of life. Amen.
And now, Mr. Farrell and our senior class reps will come forward to help with the distribution of symbols. As your names are called out, please come forward and receive these symbols as a reminder of your commitment.
Jack Travers, Tony Wang, Beto Wetter, George Wisniewski, Austin Wu, concept of leadership is a little challenging, just because as you grow and as you develop, you're making a move from thinking about all the things that happened to you. You're the narrator of your story. It's the most important story to you. What happened to me this day? What did so-and-so say to me today? I didn't get to play in such and such a game as much as I wanted to today. I had this issue with this teacher with my homework today. It's a lot of me, me, me. It's truly what happens as you develop. Challenge of leadership is how you start thinking about where you interact with others, your placement for others, among others. Richard Rohr, whose writings have been a big influence for me, for Mr. Vasquez, has written about Aboriginal culture in Australia, in which they take a young man, older boy, he goes through any number of rituals and trials, the end of which the individual has to go on a long walk up a relatively steep mountain, and at the top is a sharp implement, a knife, a cutting tool. Without all of those trials, without all of those that period of exploration, that cutting tool would just be something like, oh cool, I'm going to go mess around with this. This is fun. I'm going to carve inappropriate things under a table in the Columbus room or whatever that is, right? That's because you actually haven't developed. But what this exercise does, sorry, I'm going to shift gears there. Okay, but anyway, what this exercise does within the culture, when they get that cutting tool, when they get that implement, they actually come with, oh, I need to use this for my community. This tool isn't about me. It's about how I can contribute, whether that be with crops or building or what have you. It's making that move from how is this about me, how is this about my fun, how I can up my level of pleasure or enjoyment, and move toward how can I be a person for others. Years pass. Freshmen, I'll make this up to you. When you miss this, I'll go into the whole thing about the elephants and the bull elephants and how they regulate on the young elephants. We're just going to save that for next year. This year, what I want to do is share some bullet points also from Richard Rohr. Went through all this. Do I read this out loud? Do I hand this out? I actually can hand it out for any of you guys who would like this afterward. This is a nice reflection. What every good leader knows. Good leaders move forward by influencing events and inspiring people more than by ordering or demanding. Good leaders know that every one-sided solution is doomed ahead of time to failure. It is never a final solution, but only a postponement of the problem. Good leaders learn to study, discern, and search together with their people for solutions. Good leaders know that total dilemmas are very few. We create many dilemmas because we are internally stuck, attached, fearful, over-identified with our position, needy of winning the case, or unable to entertain even the partial truth that the other opinion might be offering. Good leaders search for a middle ground where the most people can find meaning. They work for win-win situations. This is hard to do if you assume that you are the higher, the more responsible, the in charge, the senior, the more competent, or once you have made a harsh judgment about the other. Good leaders know there is no perfect solution. That is the lie and false promise of the dualistic mind, polarity, and all or nothing thinking. Good leaders know that seeking exclusive is an easy way out, and often just a sign of laziness or fear of taking responsibility. Good leaders know that the rule of law and obedience can inform you only about what is illegal or immoral. It cannot of itself lead you to God, truth, goodness, or beauty. Good leaders know that when done well, compromise and consensus seeking is not a way of abdicating in essential values, but very often a way of seeking and finding other values, especially community building, along with giving more people a personal investment in the outcome. Good leaders know that wisdom is the art of the possible. The key question is no longer, how can I problem solve now and get this off my plate? It is, how can this situation achieve good for the largest number and for the next generations? Good leaders know that rapid recourse to the law or to rules might be seeking the will of God or the mission of an organization, but it might also be seeking to avoid the responsibility, the necessary self-doubt, the darkness, and the prayer required to live in faith, hope, and love. Good leaders keep prayerfully offering new data until they can work towards some consensus from all sides. Good leaders want to increase both freedom and ownership among the group, not just subservience, which will ultimately sabotage the work anyway. And finally, good leaders let people know the why of a decision and show how it is consistent with the group's values. In short, good leaders must have a certain capacity for non-polarity thinking and full access knowing, prayer, a tolerance for ambiguity, faith, an ability to hold creative tensions, hope, an ability to care, love, beyond their own personal advantage.
Members of the senior class of Stuart Hall High School. And so together, let us all.